the ideas in all of this.
Okay.
So this is almost clear. It's an origin of loss. Oh, okay. I thought I was even very loud. I didn't know I wasn't loud enough. All right, so I'm reading from an origin of loss. So this is it. It happens that the older a man becomes, the more advanced challenges become. For Lekara, it was a new challenge. When the child came, it was as if they had not seen or planned or arranged that they would work harder and that they would eat only twice a day and they would make sure that the newborn involved in a certain world was fine. They had suspended the oil to own two cars. They took turns to drive their own car to work, and when it screamed to be changed, they played music to drown the noise. And when the baby came, the person who got the car weekly was the one who took the child to the crèche for that week. Every day, the challenges intensified, and soon the sex drive dropped, and one of the pairs could sleep on the couch for a month without a feeling of guilt. In a month or two, they only kissed, maybe twice or less. Lekara worked with a man who understood hard work as longer than an hour in the office, and he hooked her on the job with the promise of a promotion, which was to come and with a fair rate. And as sad as it may sound, she had already planned how she would spend her raise. While the rent was due, she would put some money aside for a piece of land. If they could save up for a year or two, they could get a piece of land somewhere remote, build a two-bedroom apartment on it, and then manage the distance where, while saving for their child's education. They had worked it out on paper and knew it was the right step to take. To quit paying rent and to invest in a new money instead of different things that never added much value. When they worked with a government ministry, and those things had changed since the birth of the child, he still spent his lunch break on a phone call to Lekara, teasing her, fantasizing about seeing her during work hour. He would tell her that if he could, he would sneak into her office and pretend to be a mail delivery man just to kiss her and run away. And she would laugh and tell him they needed a small amount of break, however small. They get away to somewhere to be together, love each other privately, recharge what they felt on the first day they met at a singing concert. Her music had united them. While they were singing and waving hands in the air, their body had brushed against each other and apologies became pleasantries. And they went on a date at the shrine. They were the weird couple of Lagos. People visited fun places for dates, but they chose Fela's Shrine, a place where the air was broken by a strong presence of marijuana and undimmed joy. And maybe it was what kept bringing them to the shrine, or maybe it was just the live music or the essence of the shrine, that it had a bit of Fela, his spirit, his power, transformation in music, or maybe it was affordable, ripped of a kind of resistance fellow representative. When Mwene got a government job, he convinced his woman to join him in Port Harcourt. Lekara was a Port Harcourt girl, but she did not believe it was a man who would bring her back to the city she grew up in as a child. She had been born in the Wunga Valley on a street called Odu, where she played in the rain and held hands with friends on her return from school. She had thought she would marry an Ikwerre man, one from Odu someday, because all the older women in the area called her the wife of their sons, and they meant it with a pureness that could be seen in their eyes. And as she became a teenager and her body changed, their sons greeted her more often and wanted small talks. They smiled, and when she walked past, they asked for her phone number until her parents moved to Lagos. In Lagos, after university, she joined a small cast of a sitcom and became locally popular. But soon after, she landed a better job on the board of a new betting company and retired from acting before she even started. In Port Harcourt, she found a job as an underwriter with an insurance company, and though it did not pay like her Lagos job, it kept her away from cameras, lights, and people who easily drew comparison between character and life of the actor. Lekara reassured herself that the Port Harcourt job came with the promise of her own home, with her man and the hope of a child. They enjoyed their first year of planning and saving, and when the baby came, they felt it would be easy, but that too came with surprises. a bag of rice sold for price the usual amount. Here, price increased, everything changed, and all their plans went to the ruin. They had to start to hold on to their jobs tightly. Their baby grew in size and knew love as much as they could give. When they got home and tiredness knew their names and called, they carried the baby, sang for him, and told stories until they drew away. But somehow those who lived around them said they were a perfect couple. Maybe because Lekara maintained great physical shape after the delivery of her child, or maybe because Mwele also worked out despite the odds and could pass for a long mother. However, anyone who peeked into their lives intently would know it was a distorted piece of art in glossy print. On one wet Monday in early August, Mwele had to run to the Ministry of Commerce where he worked for a monthly biometric clearance, and Lekara had to send some documents to clients. She drew her plans and timed when she would drop off her baby at the crèche while Mwele was gone. And then she would head to the office to do her bit of work. She wrapped the baby against cold and dropped her at the back seat and drove. The rain thickened and the traffic grew longer than usual, and her phone rang incessantly. And the threat from her boss came through. She could have talked the phone away if it were some classmate, her mother or father who gave her the kind of stress. But this was the source of her many dreams of, and a promotion was around the corner. She turned on the radio and like there was a divine hand working in her favor that morning, Joromi by Simi came on, and she became lost in the lyrics while she struggled to calm down her boss whom she had now answered his call, and he kept reiterating the importance of the clients they were to deliver the insurance policies to. She got to the office, back to her car, picked up her bag and ran upstairs to help her raging boss fix things. She knew if she finished the job early enough, the man would not be angry about her lateness. She got to her desk and got engrossed in preparing documents. By the time she realized how much she had worked, it was noon and a harsh sun was up in the sky, helping to dry the wet land soaked by the morning rain. And Mwele called to tease her as usual, to tell her that he would not come as a delivery guy anymore, but disguised as a woman. And though he wore a beard, he would be shown to her office, and she would be shocked at the sight of a full frame man dressed like a woman, but with cute lipsticks. They laughed and she blushed. He asked how the baby was feeling when she dropped him off at the crèche, despite the weather. Lekara dropped her phone and let out a deafening scream that brought everyone to her desk. It was a dream, she said to herself. And before everyone could ask her what the trouble was, she had raced downstairs to her car. When she got there and looked through the window, her baby had passed out. His lifeless body head hung through a belt that once kept him safe. He had been locked there since morning and had suffocated. Lekara